hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all.
Lord of all.
Ye chosen seed of Israel's race, ye ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saves you by his grace and crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saves you by his grace and crown him Lord of all.
Lord of all,
you are Lord of all.
Jesus,
Lord of all, you are Lord. Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial bow, to him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him. The grace of God has reached for me and pulled me from the raging sea, and I am safe on the solid ground. The Lord is my salvation. I will not fear when darkness. His strength will help me scale these walls. I'll see the dawn of the rising sun. The Lord is my salvation. Who is like the Lord our God, strong to of need. When I am lost, when I
Got some serious pipes. That was awesome. Thank you so much for helping us. Thank you for singing. I'm glad you're all here. Look at this. Unbelievable. You didn't let the snow stop you.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You know, all that work and clearing up the church and then no one came, that would be tough, you know? And so thank you guys for clearing out your house, right? And then coming to church. It was not easy. So may the Lord bless you for doing that. I want to welcome you to Calvary Baptist. We're here to worship the Lord. We got three people, actually, that we're going to present to the church. Hopefully, we have enough. I think we have enough members here to, no?
We do.
We do. Okay. I was looking at you, Glenn. just to say amen and welcome them to the membership of Calvary Baptist. And so we'll do that later on this morning. But let me have a word of prayer. And then we will go around and greet one another. Give a fist bump if you got a cold. And if you don't have a cold, you know, you can give a hug and a holy kiss, whatever the Lord leads you to do. All right? But there's a bulletin that I actually printed the bulletins today because my wife got my cold. And so she's home and not feeling well. She tried to go, but I made her stay. And so there's different announcements there and things that are going on that we'll share later on. And if you have any kind of prayer requests or anything you want to communicate to the leadership of the church, there should be a card there in the pew in front of you. If not, just grab my hand and say, I need to talk to you, Pastor. Love to talk to you. All right? All right, let's pray. Thank you, Lord God, for allowing us to gather together this morning. I thank you so much for each one here, and I pray your blessing upon them. I pray, God, that you will bless them for coming out to worship you here at Calvary Baptist. And thank you for this church, Lord. Thank you for providing all of our needs, physically and spiritually. And we ask that you would be glorified as we sing unto you, as we hear your word and respond to it, and as we give generously back to you for blessing us. And I just thank you, God, all the workers that you provided for us, who shoveled the snow and prepared the grounds. And even as we have the Lord's Supper later on, those who prepared for that and the fellowship, God, you've blessed us with so many servants, and we are so thankful for those who are faithful. And we thank you, God, for what you're doing here at Calvary, and we just give you all the glory for that. Bless this service. May you be glorified as we sing and hear your word, and as we give unto you. And I pray all this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. Greet one another.
I got your signal.
Huh? What are you doing?
I was like, I thought you were saying.
No, I'm just.
Okay.
We can have Michaela now. We got it.
I love her boots.
My heart is so proud. My mind is so unfocused. I see the things you do through me as great things I have done. And now you gently break me, and lovingly you take me and hold me as my father, and mold me as my maker. I ask you, how many times will you pick me up when I keep on letting you down? And each time I will fall short of your glory, how far will forgiveness abound? And you answer, my child, I love you. And as long as you're seeking my face, you'll walk in the power of my daily sufficient grace. At times I may grow weak and feel a bit discouraged, knowing that someone somewhere could do a better job. For who am I to serve you? I know I don't deserve you, and that's the part that burns in my heart and keeps me hanging on. Will forgiveness abound? And you answer, my child, I love you. And as long as you're seeking my face, you'll walk in the power of my daily sufficient grace. You are so patient with me. The price that I could never pay was paid at Calvary. So instead of trying to repay you, I'm learning to simply obey you by giving up my life to you for all that you've given to me. I ask you, how many times you pick me up when I keep on letting you down? And each time I will fall short of your glory, how far will forgiveness abound? And you answer, my child, I love you. And as long as you're seeking my face, you'll walk in the path of my daily sufficient grace.
Now
Now, this next song we're going to sing before the message is going to talk about God's faithfulness. And just like in the song we just sang, we let God down so many times. And so much of the time, we move so far away from God. But God is so faithful, we always can come back to him. But the difference is, God's not coming back to us. Because God is faithful. God was always with us. He's that faithful. We should be so faithful as well. Amen. Let's sing about God's faithfulness.
There's some great songs that we were given to sing today. I hope you enjoyed each one of them. I surely did. And just every one of those songs go great with the passage that we're looking at this morning. And so we're going through a new series, 1 Corinthians. And the message today is God's grace toward us. And if you have your Bibles, you can open up your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We're going to be looking at verses 4 through 9. If you don't have a Bible, it is as a pew Bible there in front of you. And it's on page 657 of that pew Bible. And as a gift for coming here to Calvary, if you don't have a Bible at home, feel free to keep that Bible that you have. If you like it, you can keep it. All right? If you don't like it, just put it back on the behind the pew. And as we get to know you, you come more often, and we find out that you don't have a Bible, we'll be glad to buy you a beautiful Bible because we believe God's Word is important for you to have to read. So speaking of reading God's Word, if you found 1 Corinthians chapter 1, I'd like to read verses 4 through 9 and ask the Lord to bless His Word to our lives. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, looking at verses 4 through 9. I thank my God always concerning you for the grace of God which was given to you by Christ Jesus, that you were enriched in everything by Him, in all utterance and in all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that you come short in no gift, eagerly waiting for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will also confirm you to the end, that you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Father in heaven, we are so thankful that you are a faithful God. We're thankful to you, God, that you will always be faithful to your promises. You don't change your mind. If you promise us in your word, your promises will always come true. And Lord, all those you've chosen before the foundation of the world, all those you've called through the gospel, are secure forever in the fellowship of your dear Son, and you will confirm us in the end because you are faithful. You are a faithful God. Faithful is God Almighty, and we praise you for that. We pray that you would be glorified as we read and understand your word today. Pray that the Holy Spirit would give us understanding and help us to hear well. We want to worship you, God, as we listen to your word preached, and help me to teach it well and give each one ears to hear and eyes to see and a heart to understand. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, as I said, we're in a wonderful, wonderful study of 1 Corinthians. Paul begins the book by encouraging these believers at Corinth. They're living in a city that is full of debauchery and wickedness. It's a real wicked city that they're living in. The church is slowly developing. He spends these first 9 verses just encouraging them, trying to get them to see who they are in Christ Jesus. And not only is God speaking to the Corinthian church, but you know that this is God's living word. And 2,000 years later, it applies to your life and my life. And so God wants to encourage every believer that you belong to Jesus no matter what is going wrong in your life, no matter how hard things are. I believe that we can relate to the words that God gives to the Corinthians 2,000 years or so ago for us today to learn and to understand. And just by way of reminder, this is pretty much an introduction that he's given here in these first 9 verses. When he gets to verse 10 and all the way to the rest of the book, Paul is going to spend the rest of the time just correcting wrong behavior, correcting wrong thinking, and getting them to see some of the things that are going wrong in their life, and always, always pointing them to the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. It was the gospel that saved them. It is the gospel that the power of that gospel is going to keep them walking on the straight and narrow. And so Paul is going to be pointing them to the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, if you look at these verses that we're looking at this morning, verses 4 all the way to verse 9, every single verse has the name of Jesus in it. These are Christ-centered verses. The gospel is all about Jesus. And so Paul, under the power and inspiration of the Holy Spirit, is pointingly pointing them to the Lord Jesus Christ. It is Jesus that saved them. It is Jesus that is going to sustain them and keep them all the way to the end. And so last week, just by way of reminder, Paul begins the introduction of this letter by reminding them that he's an apostle. Why is he saying that? Because he speaks with authority. And there were some in the church, the false teachers, that were trying to get people not to believe Paul's words. So he says, I'm an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ. God's called me to be apostle. Hear the word of the Lord. It's kind of like an Old Testament prophet would say, thus saith the Lord. And then when he made that statement, you would know that this is a prophecy coming from God Almighty. And then he begins to speak to the church there in verse 2 and reminding them that, first of all, they are the church. And that word church means ecclesia. They're called out of darkness. And God called them out of the darkness to be his own special people. So no matter how sinful things are going on and the battles that they're having in their life, to be reminded that you're still the church, that you're called out by God, is a great encouragement, but it also is a sober reminder. Don't go back to the way you used to live. You've been called out of that. That is what the gospel is all about. God called us out of the darkness into his marvelous light. And then he describes the believers in verse 2 as those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, as those who were called to be saints. And so those are wonderful terms that you should think of, that God looks at you as a sanctified believer. Sanctified means that you are set apart. God sets you apart to be divinely and to be used by God Almighty, like the sacred instruments of the temple, like the temple itself, like the priests who are consecrated, holy, to be used for God and God alone. God does that with the believer. Every one of us who have asked Jesus to come into our life and to save us, those who are following Jesus, you are sanctified. In other words, God looks at you now, no matter how messed up life might be for you, and he says you're holy. He sees you spiritually as holy before God. That's a position that will never, ever be lost. But practically, God wants us to not just hear that in the sky there and say, oh, I'm holy. No, because you are holy, because you and I are holy, every commandment that God gives in the scriptures is given to people who are already holy. In other words, this is who you are. Now act like you are. Act like you are. So we are holy, but yet we must be holy, for he is holy. And then that last term he gives, that we are saints. The term saints is not to be used just for those who live a life of good works and sacrifice things like Mother Teresa and the different saints that are in the Catholic Church. Every believer in the Lord Jesus Christ is called a saint. Look at the Bible. The Bible calls you a saint. And that word saint is from the same word holy, which simply means that you're a holy one. You're a holy one. God sees you positionally as his holy one. And it's not just the Corinthian church. He says, this is with all who in every place call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, both theirs and ours. This is the universal call for every believer all over the world. Every believer is God's holy ones. And we're called out. And so that word holy doesn't just mean that we're supposed to be separate from the world. We ought to be separate. We ought not to live the way the world is living. But it goes further than that, because God the Father is holy, God the Son is holy, and God the Holy Spirit is holy. But they're not separate from each other. They are fully devoted to each other. Their holiness is what draws them together. And so God wants us to be holy, not just positionally, but practically. We ought to be living lives fully devoted to being holy, living for the Lord. And so he gives commandments in the Bible. And one of them that I'll read to you, because of the snow and all that, we didn't get a time to get all these verses up, and I didn't give this to Mark. But he might be quick enough to get it. I don't know. Colossians chapter 3, see how fast he is. Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Look at how this tells us in Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. He says this: "If you then were raised with Christ, seek those things which were above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. For you died, and your life is hidden with God, with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory." You see, those verses are describing who you are. This is your position. This is how God sees you. You've been raised with Christ, right? And then he gives the commandment. Since you've been raised with Christ, then set your mind on things above. You died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. So positionally, this is how God sees us. But then verse 5 says, "Therefore, since this is who you are, put to death your members, your sinful members that are on the earth, fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desire, covetousness, which is idolatry. Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience." So God's word is saying that this is who you are, and since you are this, then therefore you have the potential and the power and the ability to put these things to death that are sinful in God's eyes. Is it going to happen overnight? Is it happen, boom, like right away, all of a sudden you put those things to death? No, it's a process that of called sanctification. As we die to ourselves and we submit to the Lord and we take his word into our life and we obey what his word is saying, this happens. We're putting to death these things that God says are sinful. We're not to live the way the world lives. We're to live separate from them. Put these things to death. And in doing these things, brothers and sisters, this is causing us to be fully devoted to holiness. We're pursuing that in our life. And so this is what we've learned last week. Now looking at verses 4 through 9, what we have here is now Paul is going to begin to thank God for something. He's going to thank God for the Corinthians because something happened in their life that causes Paul to be so thankful to God. And you know what that is? It's God's grace. God was graceful to the Corinthians. Now, you need to understand this, and I believe that when a believer fully understands God's grace toward them, it changes their life. It'll radically change your life. And Paul begins this letter in verse 4, thanking God for the grace of God which was given to them, to the believers, in Christ Jesus. And so there's three aspects of grace that these verses are going to talk about. They're going to talk about a past grace, a present grace, and a future grace. A past grace, a present grace, and a future grace. But before we look at these aspects of grace. What is grace? What does it mean when the Bible says that God is graceful toward a person? Well, in a simplistic way, grace is God blessing undeserved sinners with the forgiveness of their sins, which is found only in Christ Jesus. God is graceful to undeserved sinners. As soon as you think in your mind that you deserve something from God, you're nullifying grace. The word, the meaning of grace is God is giving you something you don't deserve. And the moment we understand how sin has affected our life, when the Bible says, for instance, for all have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God, that there's none good, no, not one, that's God's word. It's painting a picture of every single one of us. He says that we are dead spiritually, dead in our trespasses and our sins. That's describing the sinful nature of a person. And so that type of a person is not seeking after God, doesn't love God the way they're supposed to, is not living life the way God wants them to live. And the reason why they're not living the way God wants them to live is because they're unable to. They're totally depraved and not able to glorify and to praise God the way they should, because the Bible says, for all have sinned and have come short of the glory of God. So the standard, let's look at the Ten Commandments, right? If you're familiar with those Ten Commandments, this is the standard that God wants us to live by. And no one, nobody can live those Ten Commandments perfectly without breaking one. And so therefore, we're all undeserved. We've sinned before God, but God is a graceful God. And he shows his grace in the full extent of God's grace is shown in the person of Jesus Christ. God has always been a God who is full of grace and full of mercy. But his grace is much more demonstrated, if I can put it that way, in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Think of the man Jesus who never sinned, who never did anything wrong in his life. Jesus is the only one who never lied, who never stole. He always loved God. He always put God the Father first. He lived a pure and holy life. Yet he was treated as though he was public enemy number one. He was treated as though he was the worst, most vilest sinner on this planet. He was hung on a cross for 6 long hours, and God gave Jesus what you and I deserve. God punished his son in our place. And so God is graceful. And so Paul begins this letter by first thinking of the grace of God that was given to these believers. And just for further understanding of what grace means, grace cannot coexist with human effort. Grace cannot coexist with human effort. In other words, you and I can never achieve God's grace through human effort. No amount of good works, good living, will cause God to look down from heaven at a sinner who has broken his laws and see, oh, he's doing some good thing. She's doing some good. No. Grace cannot coexist with human effort. If it does, it nullifies grace. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9 say this: for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. So grace cannot coexist with human effort, nor can grace coexist with human obligation. Grace cannot coexist with human obligation. Grace ceases to be grace if we can pay God back for saving us. Grace is not a loan. Salvation is not a loan that you can pay God back for. The moment you try to pay God back for the grace that he gave you in Christ Jesus, you're looking at it like it's a job. I earned this. I worked for this, and therefore God was graceful to me. You get paid for working, but you can't pay God for what he's given you. It's of infinite value. Jesus is too pure and too holy. We are too sinful and too far away from God. We can never pay God back for what he's done. All we can do is serve God out of a grateful heart and show him that we love him. And so that is what grace means. And in this passage, there are three aspects to God's grace. There is a past grace, a present grace, and a future grace. The past grace is that it is found in Christ Jesus. Grace was given to you. In verse 4, you see that? The grace that was given to you in Christ Jesus. And what Paul is talking about there is salvation. He's talking about that God gave them forgiveness of their sins. And what does forgiveness of sins do? when God forgives you of your sins, it removes guilt. It removes guilt before God now and forever. You see, our sin was dealt a decisive blow by Christ on the cross. In dying for us, he defeated our sin. And by his obedience, he secured my freedom. In other words, I will never have to pay for my sins. I will never have to pay for my sins. Through his blood, Jesus' blood, I and my conscience have been cleansed of all my sin and my guilt that is associated with it. My conscience has been cleansed so that I should never, ever live in the guilt of my sin. The Bible says in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, that there is now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. There's no condemnation. In other words, no matter how many times you or I sin, because of Christ and God's grace, God will never condemn you. God will never disown you. God will never put you or I on a shelf called useless. God will never put you in a box called shame. Condemnation does not come from God toward the believer. All those kinds of condemnation, shame, guilt, hopelessness are all self-made or from the enemy, the devil himself. There is no condemnation. I must realize that when I sin, God does not reject me. He does not hold it against me. He has forgiven me of all of my sin. But listen, I know some of you were thinking this. Don't confuse condemnation with conviction. Don't confuse condemnation with conviction. We are not now, nor will we ever be condemned by God if you are a believer in Christ Jesus. But conviction is the work of the Holy Spirit. Conviction is the warning mechanism that you have sinned. And to not respond to conviction of the Holy Spirit being placed upon your life is to ask God for discipline. If you don't respond to the conviction of doing something wrong as a believer, you are asking God to discipline you. But once you respond to conviction, and once confession and reconciliation has been sought, because of God's grace toward me, I am free. I am free. And so, like Paul does in the beginning of this letter, in verse 4, he thanks God for God's grace toward the Corinthians. And I believe that that reminds you and reminds me that we ought to also be very thankful toward God for the grace that he's given you and I in Christ Jesus. If you're here today and you've turned from your sins and you've placed your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, you've experienced grace from God. You did not deserve it. You'll never be condemned. As you do things wrong in this life, you will be convicted. If you're not convicted, that's another problem to talk about. But as the Holy Spirit convicts you, you must respond to that conviction. But God will never, ever condemn you. At the cross, he secured your freedom and he cleansed you of all of your sins and all of the guilt associated with your sin. And so when you sin, don't live in the past. Don't live in this. Don't live and hold on to that sin. If you do, God will discipline you. Confess it to him and you will find freedom which is found in Christ Jesus. Amen. And so that is past grace, but the text also reveals to us a present grace. Look at verses 5 through 7. He says that he's thanking God regarding this grace that was given to them in Christ Jesus, and then he begins to explain this present grace. So it's not something from the past, it's a present grace. He says, "You were enriched in everything by him in all utterance and all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that you come short in no gift." And so this is a grace that enables you and I to live the way God wants us to live. It is, we've been enriched in everything, and that we come short and no gift whatsoever. And so when God saved us, he was graceful. Because of his past grace, we also, though, have a present grace and a future grace that God says. He says that every believer is enriched in everything by him in all utterance and in all knowledge. God has given every believer, because of his grace, he's given every believer everything you and I need to live a life to glorify God. He has enriched us. In other words, every believer is rich. Now, he's not talking about a physical wealth. He's talking about a spiritual wealth. God's grace that was given to the believer, because you are saved, you've been given everything that you need. And as Peter would say in 1 Peter, everything for life that pertains to life and godliness has been given to the believer. You are rich spiritually. If you want to live for God, you can live for God. Just as he says there in verse 2 that you are holy positionally, God also wants you to understand that you are rich. You are rich because of what Christ has done. So if you want to live for God by walking on the pathway he's given you, God has given you everything you need to be both happy and successful in accomplishing that goal. And so he mentions three things there. He mentions that he's made us rich in all utterance, in all knowledge, and in coming short of no gift. Now, what does he mean by all utterance and in all knowledge? That word utterance is the Greek word logos, L-O-G-O-S. It simply means to speak. You'll see that word later on where in verse 18 of chapter 1, he says, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those. It is the logos, the message, the speaking of the message is foolishness. And so God's word is saying that God has given every believer all that they need to speak for him. Speaking for God is not to be left just for the professionals. God's word is saying to every believer that God, because of God's grace, he's given you the ability to be able to speak for God Almighty. Now, we might not have all the same eloquence. I certainly believe this, that we don't have the same vocabulary level. Nor do we all have the same ability to captivate people with an attractive personality. But God has gifted every believer with the ability to speak his truth and to speak his truth in love. The Corinthians, he's going to correct them later on, they abused the gift of speech with the gift of tongues. And God rebuked them in chapter 12 by saying they were able to speak, but they didn't have love. And you and I can speak the truth in love. Every one of us are able to speak God's words to whoever God puts in our place. Now, we ought to be, instead of shrinking back in unbelief and not believing that, we ought to be like the believers were in Acts chapter 4. They were being persecuted and told to shut up, stop talking about Jesus. And their lives were threatened. And what did they do? Just normal believers. They didn't shrink back in unbelief and say, no, I can't do this anymore. They prayed. And they asked God for boldness. And when God heard that prayer for boldness, God answered their prayer, and they were able to speak the truth in boldness. Now listen, if you want to walk the pathway that God wants you to walk, if you want to be a witness for God, you must pray and ask God for boldness, and he will give you the boldness because he's given you everything. Everything you need to serve God has been given to you. You'll be able to speak for God. So pray and then trust him to use you. Not only are we given everything regarding words, we can speak truth, but he says that we have all knowledge. All knowledge. This doesn't mean that we know everything. That would be counter to what having teachers and having the Holy Spirit. It's not saying that we know everything, but the Holy Spirit has given us light to the revelation so that we may know all things. Right now, we only know in part. But the knowledge is available to you and I. It's not that we can't know what we need to know. It's that we don't appropriate the knowledge that he has given to us. But he has given us both his knowledge and the Holy Spirit to know the things that were given to us. Both knowledge and the Spirit. So we don't speak in a vacuum, not knowing what to speak. But he's given us the truth of God's word so that we can speak the knowledge that he's given to us. So God has given us all speech. We have the ability to speak, but we must open our mouths in order to use it. God has given us all knowledge, but we must appropriate it. And just as God has been gracious in giving us salvation, he's also been gracious in gifting us with the ability and made us fit for the kingdom of God to serve him. This last aspect of having present grace, the ability to serve God, is that we've come short in no gift. Now, I'm not going to get into all the different spiritual gifts when we get to chapter 12, and we'll discuss these things. If you can't wait, just come and see me at the church. I'll give you something, all right? But here he's talking about that we've come short in no gift. That doesn't mean that believers have every single one of the spiritual gifts, but every believer has a spiritual gift that God has given to you so that you can serve him. In other words, God's word is saying that you're not lacking. No believer is lacking in the ability to serve God. We have the ability to serve God. But sometimes, because of indifference or ignorance, many believers take years to recognize and to develop the gift that God has given to them so they can bring glory to God. But we need to recognize that we have them. We need to identify that we have spiritual gifts, and we need to use them. We need to use the spiritual gifts that we have. Just as God has given us everything physically to live, we have arms, we have legs, we have eyes, we have a brain, we have ears. Everything physically to live and to move about, we have. He doesn't add more to that, does he? No, everything, we're a full package and all ready to go, right? In the same way, every believer has been given every spiritual gift that they need. Right now, God has gifted you with the ability to serve him. You don't have to wait. He's not going to add more later. Everything you need is given to you right now, presently, to serve God. And the reason why we don't use it or don't know what our spiritual gifts are is because we're not using it. We're not serving the Lord. And as soon as you start serving the Lord, you will see the spiritual gift that God has given to you. So don't be lazy, don't be sinful, and keeping yourself from being used by God. He has given you everything you need to be happy. Everything you need to be successful in serving the Lord has been given to you. God wants you to appropriate it, all that he's given to you. And so we'll get into the further detail of what those spiritual gifts are later on. But just by encouragement, past grace, God's forgiven you of all your sins. Present grace is that he's given you the ability to serve him and to glorify him and to be the most happiest person on this planet. That's God's grace. And it's a grace that he's given to you so that you can serve him. Lastly, in the latter half of verse 7 and all the way down to verse 9, this is a future grace, a grace that keeps you and me. And so, starting in verse 7, he says that you've come short in no gift, eagerly waiting for the revelation of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will confirm you to the end that you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And so Paul is saying that you have a past, you've experienced past grace. You are experiencing now a present grace. But there's a future grace that God wants us to understand. A future grace. God's grace in saving us, you and me. But God is going to make sure that everyone he saved is going to make it all the way to the end. In other words, all those whom God has chosen to be his believers. Before the foundation of the world, Ephesians chapter 1, God has chosen us in Christ. And it says there in Ephesians chapter 1, as a matter of fact, I'd like you to turn to that. It's a powerful, powerful verse. I don't understand all of it. I'll start reading in verse 3 of chapter 1 of Ephesians. He said, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ." Catch these words, verse 4. "Just as he chose us, believers, in him." When did he do it? "Before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love." And so what's the goal of our salvation? That we're going to be standing before God, holy and without blame before him in love. And when did God make that choice to save people? He made it before the foundation of the world. You and I didn't do anything to deserve God's grace, nor can we do anything to keep God's grace. God is graceful to us. He took wretched sinners and was graceful to them. And every time you mess up, God's not going to say, "Up, that's it. I'm done with you." No. In the same way that God was graceful to saving us when we were wretched, every time we mess up, God is still going to be graceful, and he's going to keep us all the way to the end so that we stand before God and he'll confirm us and say, "I paid for that person's sins." In other words, God's not going to look at you when you stand before him someday and say, "Guilty." No, because you're in Christ Jesus, you have future grace. God planned this from the beginning. God is not going to change his mind. God planned it from the beginning. If you are in Christ Jesus, you will stay in Christ Jesus all the way to the end. And when you stand before God, God will confirm that you are truly one of his children. You are blameless before his sight. You might not feel it now. You might not see it now. But little by little, God is transforming your life. And you'll stand before God someday as a blameless child of God with no guilt. All of your sins have been forgiven. So a past grace, a present grace, and a future grace. This is all going to come to confirmation. God is going to do this. And there's a passage in Jude that I want to show you. Jude 24. Can you put that up for me, Mark? Jude 24. Look at that. "Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling." All right? What is God's grace able to do? Now, when he says keep you from stumbling, he's not saying keep you from sinning, right? I wish that were true. But keep you from stumbling means that when we sin and when we mess up, we're never, ever, ever, ever going to stumble to such a degree that we stumble and sin permanently and are separated from God forever and ever. It will never, ever happen. Amen? We are going to be one day, he's able to keep you and I from stumbling permanently. And I praise God because I know I need that. I need God's grace to keep me from stumbling permanently because we all mess up. And praise God's grace that he'll keep us from stumbling. And look, and to present you faultless before the presence of the glory. One day it's going to happen. Some from every tribe, tongue, and nation that are here today and all over the world are going to be gathered around the throne. God's going to see them blameless, faultless before the throne of God's glory. Ain't that a wonderful thing? Amen? I always feel like praising the Lord, don't you? It's a wonderful, wonderful truth. Jesus says the same thing, and I don't want you to turn to it, but and we get a chance to read this in John 17, Jesus' prayer. He says this in John 17, 12. "While I was with them in the world, I kept them in your name. Those whom you gave me, I have kept. And none of them is lost except the son of perdition." That would be Judas, right? He was lost. And it says that the scripture might be fulfilled. Judas was lost because he never was a true believer. Every true believer in Christ Jesus has experienced past grace. You can experience present grace if you start serving the Lord, because God's enriched you to do it, but you will experience a future grace. All those he's justified, it says he's also glorified. It is a done deal. In God's eyes, we will see him one day. And so we need God's grace. He's given us his grace, and we are benefits of this wonderful, wonderful grace. So Look how he ends this. Why do we know that God is not going to give up on us? Why do we know that we're going to be presented before God someday as blameless and faultless? Look at verse 9. God is faithful. God is faithful by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Literally, it says, faithful is God. Faithful is God. God is faithful. He's not going to change his mind. If he's called you into the fellowship of his dear Son through the blood of his Son, he's not going to change his mind and all of a sudden say, okay, I give up on this person. They just can't make it. They can't live it. God will never do that. Never do that. So there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Conviction, yes. Condemnation, no. And so how do we respond to this grace that was shown to us? How do you respond to God's grace? Do you respond like the Corinthians do to some extent, how they were abusive to God's goodness toward them? Many people, and I say this in a lack of understanding, they do not understand how sinful they are and how graceful God was toward them. Because if they did, they would not abuse God's grace. They would not do it. I don't know how you respond to that. I know how I respond to it. How do you respond to God's grace? Do you respond as maybe, for terrible illustration here, but like a bratty teenager, all right? Bratty teenagers, you constantly give and give and give, and there's no thankfulness, right? I hope none of us respond to God's grace in that way. But we respond the way God wants us to respond. How do we respond to that? We respond to God's grace by denying ungodliness. We respond to God's grace by denying ungodliness and living righteously in this present world that we're living in. That's how we respond to God's grace. We respond to God's grace because we understand that God gave us something we didn't deserve, and he's going to keep us. And we don't abuse it. We respond to it by saying, God, I love you so much for what you did for me, and I want to live for you all the days of my life. That should be our response to God's grace. May the Lord lead you this morning as we close in prayer to respond to the grace of God, God's past grace, present grace, and future grace. Let's pray. Every head bow and every eye close. And as your head is bowed, a message today was about the grace of God. How do you respond to God's grace? Does it cause you to be as Paul, thanking God for his grace toward you? Or do you think of all this and say, that's nice? God got a good thing when he got me. I hope not. But may you, in humility and thankfulness, thank him by living for him. That you would live a life of self-control, a righteous life, a life that glorifies him. Live as you have been called by God. You are holy. Father, I pray that you will have your way in all of our hearts. Lord God, I pray you would bless us with obedience. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Why don't we all stand and sing this invitational song? And as we're singing this song, if God's worked in your heart and you need prayer, you need to talk to somebody, maybe you're here this morning and you don't understand God's grace as you ought to, and you've been convicted that you need Jesus to save you, slide out of your seat and come forward, and we have a room in the back over here that's ready for that. We can sit back there and share God's word with you and help you to understand what it means to be to experience God's grace and salvation. However God's led you to do, you slide out of your seat and come forward as we sing this song. It's a little bit of a long song, but it's a good song.
Thirsty, I'm thirsty for you. In a dry land with no drink, I need you. I know you made a home inside this heart of stone, so turn it into flesh, spirit soften it. Give you all I have, holding nothing back. Jesus, I am.